This is Paul Turner, the Immigration Barrister to Imperium Chambers. This is a follow-up video, really, from the couple of videos that I've done in respect of the amnesty that doesn't exist or exists in the figment of a few people's vivid imaginations. But the purpose of this video really is to talk about the 10 years. Because the amnesty, the one that doesn't exist, talked about 10 years residence. Now, the reason why I wanted to talk about 10 years residence is that it seems to have a magic number in an awful lot of people's minds, and I'm not sure how it's been put there. Maybe it's been put there by disreputable representatives or people looking to make money. Now, there is a legitimate way of acquiring residence after 10 years in the United Kingdom outside of any of the points-based system routes or outside of being married. And that's under paragraph 276B of the immigration rules. Now, that provides that if you've had a period of 10 years continuous lawful residence, then you're entitled, subject to certain criteria, to make an application for indefinite leave to remain. It doesn't mean to say you've got to have lived in the United Kingdom for every day of those 10 years. Indeed, you're permitted to be outside the country for up to 180 days a year, or a total of 540 over the 10-year period. You can even leave the United Kingdom if you have leave when you leave, and as long as you arrive back with leave, then that won't count as a break in your residence. Your application must not fall under the general grounds for refusal, which is what happened with a lot of the Balagajari cases. They were refused under the general ground, paragraph 3225. You've got to have sufficient knowledge of language and life in the UK, the KOLL, and there are a couple of other requirements. One of the key requirements that's in there, but it's written in an unusual way, is that you can't have overstayed for periods more than 28 days. And that's in the rules. And so periods, it says quite clearly that periods of overstaying of under 28 days will be overlooked. Now, so if you meet those criteria, and I would say before you make any application, you go and see a lawyer. If you meet those criteria, then you are or should be entitled to indefinite leave to remain. What seems to have happened is that this 10 years seems to have been misinterpreted by a lot of people. And I think a number of disreputable representatives have preyed on people to say that when they get to 10 years, they can make their application. Now, why I say this is that I have people that come in and see me often, probably about once a week. It's quite a lot. And their leave ended perhaps in 2017, and they're a couple of years short of being in the country for 10 years. And then they've made a number of applications that have all been refused without a right of appeal for the last couple of years. And they come in and they say, I'm only a few months short of my 10 years. Can I make a new application? And there are other people that come in and they perhaps have leave, but there are some big gaps in their leave, way beyond the 28-day period. And they again say, well, I'm coming up to my 10 years, can I make a 10-year application? Now, the short answer is no. Now, what is disturbing is that I see a number of cases where, as I say, for example, the individual arrives in the United Kingdom in 2009. They arrive as a student, they have a PSW visa, they remain lawfully in the United Kingdom up until, say, 2016. And then their leave expires. And within the grace period of, depending on what time in 2016, 28 or 14 days, they make an application for leave to remain based on human rights. That's refused and rejected without the right of appeal. They then make, again within 14 days, another application, which is, say, rejected in 2018. Then they make another application at the end of 2018, and then they vary it for an application to set LR based upon the fact that they're coming up to their 10 years. And then that application is also refused without a right of appeal. Now, the problem is that the court's been quite clear that making applications, even if they're made within the grace period of 28 or 14 days, doesn't have the effect of extending leave. And that's quite clear. It's been the upper tribunal in the case of Junaid Ahmed, and then the Court of Appeal in another case called Ahmed last year, affirmed the principle that while you can make a valid application within the grace period, that doesn't have the effect of extending leave. Now, the reason why I'm talking about this is, as I say, I see a lot of people, as I say, often on a weekly basis, who come in and they say, I'm coming up to my 10 years, or I'm at my 10 years, I need to make a set LR application. And it's very dispiriting to have to tell people that actually your leave ended several years ago, and the fact that you've made 2-3 applications that have all been rejected is very, very, and that you have no right to remain, is very, very dispiriting. Now, the real villains in this piece are the representatives that wrongly inform individuals, in my view anyway, that they can continue to make applications, and if they make the applications within 14 days of the last application, that somehow extends their leave or will get them up to the 10 years and then they qualify for ILR. Now, the simple fact of the matter is it doesn't. The simple fact is that when leave comes to an end or you become appeal rights exhausted, there is a grace period to put in another application. If that application is successful, then the individual will qualify for a further grant of leave, depending on when the application is made, depending on how long after or how soon afterwards the application is made, will depend on the length of leave that's granted. But I cannot stress that once leave comes to an end, then that will really break the 10-year period. Now, if that message gets across and individuals realise that once their leave has ended, there is no point in making successive applications, then I will feel that this video has not been a waste of time. Because one of the reasons that I feel particularly sorry for people is, or a number of the reasons are, is that I feel that they've spent a lot of money, but often huge amounts, on making applications. If it's a family of 3 or 4, then they could have spent, just in Home Office fees, somewhere in the region of £8,000 per application. And I've seen it where there have been 2 or 3 applications. And indeed, when they come to make their hopeless application for settlement, given that the leave hasn't existed for several years, that application in itself is going to incur Home Office fees of £2,389 per person. So in my view, if your leave has come to an end and there is nothing to stop you making an application to extend your leave, but that application needs to be, if it's going to have any chance of success, backed up by as much evidence and be prepared as fully as possible by a competent professional. That is going to take me on to my next video, which is going to be the preparation and presentation of applications in order to give them the best possible chance of success or of getting a further right of appeal. The reason I mention the need for evidence is one of the other major problems that I've noticed with these successive applications for leave to remain that are hopeless is that the representatives that have prepared them have prepared essentially a covering letter saying, please find attached application for further leave to remain FP or HRO. Please do not hesitate to revert to us. And maybe there's a page of the individual's immigration history, but there's simply no evidence of private life, no evidence of family life, and no evidence of integration into the United Kingdom, and often no evidence of anything at all. Often it's a covering letter and the application form. And perhaps the individuals think that if it's the making of the application that will extend their leave, so they don't need to put any effort into it, or maybe it's the fact that the representatives know that it's pointless. But the problem is making, and sometimes, as I say, when I've seen applications that are, when they've made two or three applications, when I've looked at the representatives' letters, all that seems to have happened is that they seem to have changed the date or changed the title of the form. Now, one, that seems really unfair on an individual who's paid for the application. But more importantly, if someone comes to make a proper application for leave to remain, a proper human rights application, any new human rights application is going to be considered under paragraph 353 of the immigration rules, which is the fresh claim criteria, fresh claim test. And that's going to look at previous applications to see whether there's anything different. Now, if the previous applications have all been rubbish, then the Home Office are entitled to say, well, you've made human rights claims before, you've not advanced any evidence that you have a human rights claim. Why should we treat this human rights claim differently? Why didn't you put the evidence in earlier? And so the fact of making repetitive hopeless claims in itself can damage a proper application that's made at a later stage. Now, leaving the fixation with 10 years to one side, and looking at the period between 10 and 20 years. Again, this excludes people who perhaps qualify under one of the points-based system or qualify as a spouse. But for individuals that have been here for between 10 and 20 years, and that in itself isn't going to necessarily mean that the individual is going to be granted leave, or that the individual is going to be granted a right of appeal. And the reason for that is contained within paragraph 276 ADE of the immigration rules. And that sets out at least one criteria which is worth mentioning, which is that an individual, if they're basing it on their private life, will have to be resident in the United Kingdom for 20 years, which is a very, very long period of time. It used to be 14 years, but in 2012 it was extended to 20 years. So for individuals that have been here for 10, 12, 14, 16 years, again, I come back to the point that I'll develop later, which is the application has to be supported by significant evidence showing real integration into the United Kingdom and a deep and profound private life. And what I'll close with is I've seen applications made where the individual has been here for 18 years, but the application has been so poor, it's had a very poor covering letter, and there's nothing more than an assertion that the person is likes the United Kingdom, considers the United Kingdom their home, and I've seen excuses put forward as to why people should stay in the United Kingdom that are as silly as, it's too hot back home, I like it here. And I think the most ridiculous one was, I don't like Indian food. Now that might sound like a joke, but I've seen that written down as a reason to stay in the United Kingdom. Unsurprisingly, that application or that type of application can be certified as clearly unfounded. Now, if that happens, then the individual does not have an in-country right of appeal, and will have to either bring judicial review proceedings if they wish to challenge it, or will have to appeal from abroad. But if there is nothing in the actual application itself, even if the individual has been in the United Kingdom for 18 years, it's very likely that the upper tribunal, when considering whether the Secretary of State has acted unreasonably, will come to the conclusion that if the only reason why you want to stay in the United Kingdom is that you've been here 18 years, it's too hot and you don't like a curry, then the Secretary of State is clearly entitled to come to the view that that claim is hopeless or it's bound to fail. And I've seen that happen, and that's tragic when people have spent 18 years of their life, which is a huge chunk of anyone's life, in the United Kingdom, and they clearly deserve better and clearly didn't get the service that they deserved. So, in short, there is no magic in the sum of 10 years. There are people that will qualify under 10 years, and there is a rule for them. There are people that can qualify for in far less periods of time, under the investor schemes, under marriage, under the points-based system. So there are people that will get indefinite leave to remain well under 10 years. But 10 years itself is not a magic figure which is going to entitle you to indefinite leave to remain, or indeed any leave to remain. I'm sorry for the length of this broadcast. I've been thinking about it for a few days, but I haven't been able to make it any shorter than I have. It's a tragedy that people are deceived into making applications that the lawyers know are hopeless. What I would say is to anyone, if you are faced with a refusal or you're faced with being appeals rights exhausted, that you seek a reputable lawyer and you take their honest advice as to whether you can make a fresh application, and if you can, what do you need to put into the fresh application in order to either stand a chance of getting a visa or a chance of getting a further right of appeal. So in short, see a good lawyer, and probably not the one that put in the previous hopeless application. And if you haven't made a previously hopeless application, then and it's your first refusal, then make sure you go and see someone that's reputable. If I can help at all, and if you or a family member has an immigration problem, please do not hesitate to contact me at Imperium Chambers on 0207 242 3488, or clerks at Imperium Chambers, or at my site, theimmigrationbarrister.co.uk. I'm sorry to have gone on, but this is an important topic. There's a lot of people have suffered unnecessarily as a result of poor legal advice, and I'd like to see that stop as far as is possible, particularly in this particular area. Thank you very much for watching, if you're still watching. This is Paul Turner, the Immigration Barrister at Imperium Chambers.